the Lord. It's really an honor and a privilege to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen. It's always good to be in the presence of the Lord. There is safety, there is comfort, there is peace, there is joy in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. The world can fake all the news just to give false hope to people who are panicked. But God comes with surety and promise. He is the God of His own word. Amen. And we are so thankful this morning that we have this opportunity for God to introduce Himself to us in the Spirit through His word. So we can have this experience with God. So you can have this peace and boldness in you that you can agree with David in Psalms 23, that even though I walk the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Amen. But the problem with the world today, there is a lot of fear everywhere, from the north, east, south, and west. Amen. People are living fearfully. People are panicked. And one thing good about this coronavirus, people are very obedient to instruction. They are obedient to the instruction of authority as far as coronavirus is concerned. But you see the beauty of obedience. You can save yourself from coronavirus, but you cannot save yourself from sin. Amen? Amen? And the wages of sin is death. So we need to learn to be obedient to the word of God. And Jesus said, don't fear people or what that can only kill the flesh, but not the soul. But rather you need to fear for someone that can both destroy the body and soul in hell. And it is sin that will destroy both souls and body in hell. Amen. But I'm thank God that I'm in this safety, this place of refuge called the Church of the Living God. This is not an organization. This is not a group of people. This is the living organism indwelt by the Spirit of God. There is something so special about the church. There is something so special about the environment you feel when you enter the Church of the Living God, because we are serving a God that is living, that is alive. And He always responds to people who come to Him by faith in the Spirit and in truth. And we are serving a God that is not a man that He should lie concerning all His promises. I thank God that whenever I say, Lord, I need you, I can feel the presence of God. We are serving a God that the Bible says He is a spirit God. I cannot see Him visibly. I cannot see Him in my little eyes. But when I call His name, this God responds to that calling. And there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. He that calleth upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Indeed, God will respond, because God always responds to people who come to Him through faith in His word. Why fear for coronavirus when you should be fear for God? You should fear God. If you fear God, you will obey His word. If you fear God, you will submit Him to His spirit. If you fear God, you can walk hell. You can walk through hell. You can tell the devil in the face, bring it on. I've got what it takes to march through hell in the power of God. And that is whole world. Great is He that is in me than he that is in the world. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, because I am a believer of the name of Jesus. I've got this resurrection power inside of me. Neither anything in this world can bring me down, because we are the Church of the Living God. We are all in the fire, in the Spirit of God. We've got the Spirit of resurrection inside of us. Hey, Timothy, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power. Amen. I want to greet the church this morning. And I welcome all of you in the name of Jesus Christ. As all of you know, I've been sent forth by the Home Mission Department here in Australia to travel to some places around Australia to share the gospel, to preach the word, and to encourage people and call people to repentance. But this is the ministry that I believe that God called me in these last days, to go and preach the gospel. Jeremiah chapter 10 verse 2, the Bible said, thus saith the Lord, Lord, learn not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathens are dismayed at them. God said, learn not the ways of the heathen. So we have our own way. It's a godly way. Amen? So if the world is panic, is dismayed, frightful, fearful, terrified, vulnerable to a point they will accept any form of help, of hope, even though it's false, they still won't accept it because of fear. It paralyzes them to the core of their soul and spirit. And it is not the spirit from God. It is the spirit of the devil. And this is how my dad always said, another name of the devil is fear. Because God has not given us that spirit. If you have that spirit, then it's not the spirit of God. God has given us the spirit of power. Amen? So this morning I'm about to go into the scripture, into the word of God. I would like to extend my appreciation to the church in Shepparton for the last 5 days that I'm spending time with them, of good quality fellowship with the brethren. And we always end up late in the night, and Sister Bella has to leave early because she's always working. And we have to say goodnight like almost 2 o'clock in the morning, because we just can't leave each other. We love the fellowship. We feel the presence of God when we share the word of God. We feel God in the place. And that is one thing very good about fellowship. God always in the midst of people who love and desire the things of God. And the church is all about fellowship. If you want to isolate yourself, you're not the church. The church is fellowship. Fellowship is a must in the church. Because that's how we uplift one another. We've got different gifts in each and individual. Then we come together and share that gift and express how God deals with us. You never know, someday, somehow, you can help someone who is struggling in the church with your testimony. You can't preach here at the pulpit. Maybe you don't have any chance to come and testify, but through that fellowship, we share the same platform where we can share the word of God. And that's how we encourage one another. So I want to encourage the church this morning, always attend the fellowship. Whether it's connect group, whether it's cell group, whether it's day of prayer, whether it's church, any programs in deals with the church of the living God, and I encourage you, please attend those programs, because we need fellowship. Amen. And I also want to thank Brother Jonathan. Every day he will come and check with me. How are you, brother? Is everything okay? Do you need anything? I said, as far as I'm living under a roof, that's good. Don't worry about the breakfast, the lunch, don't worry about anything. Because I can sleep outside or on top of the roof. I can eat grass or leaves just like all these quiet beds. I'm a very easy guest to host. Don't have to worry about it. I'm not here for vacation or holiday. I'm here for the will of God. As long as I can share a word of God to someone to inspire his faith, that's it for me. Jesus said, I'm here to do the will of my Father, and my meat is to do the will of my Father. As long as I'm doing the will of my Father, I'm encouraged and inspired in my core soul this morning. So I want to thank Brother Ross, the pastor of Greater Life, who is the shepherd of this movement, and his family and the church, for giving me this opportunity to come and be a blessing to the Shepparton ministry. Also this morning I want to acknowledge my brothers from Fiji, Pastor from Carl James, Sister Lydia, Sister Asen, all of you, my Fijian families here this morning. It's really an honor to have you here, so we can come together and worship God in one place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. My wife told me last night, you don't have to brag about the post about that you thank God for coronavirus. I said, well, the problem is, this is the platform for the church. If the world don't want to listen to the preaching of the word, maybe the coronavirus will help them to repent. All things work together for the good of them that love the Lord. If God can send 10 plagues to Egypt for Pharaoh to let loose the people of God, why not coronavirus? God is in control, all for the same conclusion, that people can come to repentance. Amen? Because they will run to the hospital and the hospital will say, we don't have the cure. You come to the back and the economy system collapse. My brother John said, hey brother, I heard a rumor. And people said, if you have money in the bank, withdraw the money. Because something might happen, everything will collapse. And you can't get the money. As long as you have Jesus, you have everything. Don't worry about the money. Just worry about the Holy Ghost. You need the Holy Ghost more than anything. We're living in this day and age where God wants to tell the whole world, you need me more than anything else. Hallelujah! Let us stand this morning, arise, and turn into our scriptures. We're going to read a few scriptures this morning. Hallelujah. In Judges chapter 2. In Judges chapter 2, verse 6 to verse 10. I'm going to read this scripture to us this morning. And when Joshua had let the people go, the children of Israel went, every man unto his inheritance to possess the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua. Everybody say, and the people served the Lord. Say it again, and the people served the Lord. Because they just received their inheritance in the land that was promised to them, flows milk and honey. What makes them rejoice and serve the Lord? Because they just possess their inheritance. And the Bible says, in the days of Joshua, all of them served the Lord. And all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord that he did for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died being 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnathum, in the Mount of Ephraim, on the north side of the hill Gash. And also all that generation were gathered into their fathers. And there arose another generation. Everybody say, another generation. Another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, not yet the work which he had done for Israel. In Acts chapter 2, verse 38 to 44. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 to verse 40. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 to verse 40. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 to 40. And Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourself from this untoward generation. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them. Save yourself from this corrupt generation. Hallelujah. Let's pray this morning. Lord Jesus, our Heavenly Father, we've heard the reading of your word, O God. We pray, Lord, that you will speak to us, that your Spirit will teach us into the things of your Spirit, that we will understand, O God, what thus saith the word of God. We pray, God, that your Spirit will move mightily each and an individual in this place this morning. And we pray, God, that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. We pray that not the will of man, O God, but your will as your word says, Jesus. We thank you for this precious moment. And we pray, God, that you will lead us through in the next few minutes. And in the name of Jesus, I pray everybody say, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated this morning. This morning I want to preach to you on this topic, save yourself. Hallelujah. Let me repeat myself. Save yourself from this untoward generation. Hallelujah. The world right now is preaching the message, save yourself from coronavirus. But I'm going to tell you this morning, save yourself from this untoward generation. There is a generation in the world today who don't want to exalt God. Amen. There is a generation in this last time that they don't believe and don't want to believe the fact that there is a God who owns this universe. That there is a God who is the author and the finisher of life. There is a generation, they neglect the need that we need God this morning. Hallelujah. There is a generation, they don't believe in the power of God. And they have strange ideas about Jesus. Hallelujah. There is a generation that they don't believe the fact that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us this morning. Hallelujah. There is a generation, they don't believe that Jesus Christ is the one true God. They have a lot of information. They have a lot of interpretation about the God that we're serving. There is a generation who are in this world today that said, coming to church is a waste of time. Giving tithe and offering is the waste of money. Coming to prayer is the waste of time. You don't have to do all that. You have everything that you need. There is a generation who neglect the need that we need God more than anything else. Because they possess the inheritance. Because they receive the promises. Because they have been blessed. Because they have all these materialistic blessings that they said, we don't need God. And the King Solomon said, it is the fool. It is the foolish and the fool that said and speak to his heart that there is no God. I want to tell this whole world today, this morning, into such a time as this, if the world don't believe that there is a God, God will send message. Hallelujah. Disaster will happen. Nature will speak for itself because all the living things here on planet Earth, they respond to the word of the mighty God. They can admit that there is a God. That's why Jesus walked on water. That's why Jesus, when he speaks to the wind and to the wave, they respond, they obey to the word of God. Because they know the authority. They know the creator. They know the God that manifests in the flesh. But there is a generation in these last days. They don't want to confess that there is a God. After God pour out his spirit in the upper room in Jerusalem, in the upper church experience, after people being filled with the Holy Ghost and being baptized in the name of Jesus, the birth of the early church in the New Testament, God told Peter, you need to send the warning straight away. After they filled with the Holy Ghost, you need to tell them, save yourself from this generation. Why you need to save yourself from this generation? Because it is this generation that will bring the curse from heaven. Because it is this generation that will make God repent to the core of his heart of creating man. Just like back in the days of Noah. After he created man, he saw everything was good. Because man was confessing that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. To a point where they commit sin. To a point they have guilty conscience in their heart. When they do filthy things, evil things in their heart, in their mind. They do all kinds of things that God, the He saw man and he said, this relationship, this fellowship with man is one thing I will treasure. I love talking with man. In the cool of the day, he will walk in the midst of the garden, and he will always love to speak with Adam. He loved to have this fellowship with man because this is what he wants. He wants to have fellowship with human beings. He don't want to have fellowship only with trees and animals and living things. He loves to have fellowship with man because men are created in the image of God, and God wants nothing more than just have fellowship with mankind. But after the time that man commits sin, it gives no choice, it leaves him no choice but to separate man from the presence of God. But God was really mad. He was really mad. He was really heartbroken because the very thing that he treasured now has been taken away from the presence of God. Just take 5 chapters after Genesis 1 comes Genesis 6. When the Bible says that it repents God from creating man. It repents God. What comes after? Judgment. When God repents, judgment is coming. So I want to tell the church this morning, you better repent before God repents. When God repents of having a fellowship with you, and you are in a danger zone, judgment is coming to you. Save yourself from this generation. We need to know that we must created in a purpose to have this relationship with God. And that is number one priority with God. You need to stay in the presence. You need to have God in your heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are living in this time where technology dominates, knowledge and sin increases. Hallelujah. People here say that their opinion have some form of authority, that they just can match this life by themselves. Hallelujah. They have what it takes to survive anything that will come against them. See the pride of man. See what is in the mentality of man. See what really is in the heart of man. They think they can survive without God. And God is everything. Everybody say, God is everything.
God is everything.
Say it again. God is everything.
God is everything.
If you have everything and you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. If you have the biggest house in this whole world without Jesus, you don't have a home. If you have all the money in the world and you don't have Jesus, you don't have any treasure in your heart. Because Jesus wants to live inside your heart. He wants to give you that peace that surpasses all understanding. He wants to give you that joy that is unspeakable. He wants you to have all this peace that comes from God alone and from Him alone this morning. Hallelujah. That's why the prophet was sent to declare the will of God in the Old Testament. That's why John the Baptist came before Jesus, and all that he preached is repent, 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 repent. Why? For the kingdom of God is at hand. Prophet John preached about repent because the kingdom of God is at hand. But I want to preach the message that Noah preached, because the Bible says in Matthew 24, the return of the Son of Man will be likened to the days of Noah. But Noah's message was, repent, for judgment is coming. He said, repent, for judgment is coming. Prophet John said, you need to repent because Jesus is coming. But Noah said, you need to repent because judgment is coming. God is coming to judge this world because of sin, because there is a generation who are doing sin, who bring curse to this earth, and they want to withhold God from proceeding to the manner of grace and love to save human race. But this time he's going to come with wrath. He's going to come with hell, bring fire and stone, because he's going to judge this world. He loves to judge this world, but there will be safety in the church of the living God. Hey, Peter, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The safest place to be here on planet earth the living God. Because in the church of the living God, you have what it takes to march through hell and reach God when the trumpet sounds. You have this immortal body, this resurrection power. You have the manna from heaven that God will feed your soul on a daily basis with manna from heaven. And you will have this great faith in you, save as second, me second, identical, that they stood fastly, stand their ground on the word of God and say, hey, the book of Nazar, we don't care about the fiery furnace. We don't care how you want to threaten us, you want to challenge our faith. It's not going to happen. Even if our God didn't come and save us, it's not going to change the fact we will not going to bow, because we know that he's the God. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that God is still the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if that God parted the Red Sea, and if that God parted the Red Sea and delivered manna on a daily basis to all the children, the million of Israel, he still can save today. Amen. Amen. Let's clap our hands unto the Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah in Jesus' name. Somebody shout hallelujah in Jesus' name. John preached, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. But no, preach, repent, for judgment is coming. And Jesus said, the return of the Son of Man will be like the days of Noah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What happened when the Lord returns? He destroyed everything that is not in the ark. He destroyed everything. Everybody say, he will destroy everything. If you are not in the ark, you will be destroyed by this judgment. Hallelujah. In 1 Peter 3:18, the Bible says, for Christ also hath once suffered for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put on death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. In verse 19, the Bible says, by which also he went and preached unto the Spirit in prison, which something were disobedient. When once the long suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was in preparing, wherein few, that is eight souls, were saved by the water. In verse 21, the like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. What Peter was preaching was, as the boat saved eight people from the water in the days of Noah, in the like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. That's why Jesus said, go ye therefore into the world and preach to all creatures the gospel. He that believeth, baptized, shall be saved. He that believeth not, shall be damned. Hallelujah. Now we read in the Bible. In Mark chapter 14, verse 31. The Son of Man indeed goeth, as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Good were if for that man if he had never been born. Such a strong statement from God himself to say it would have better for this man not to be born. A statement from God himself. He was referring to Judas Iscariot. After 3.5 years fellowship spent, this great time of fellowship together, see all of these signs and wonders and miracles, but to a point of time where Judas decided to betray Jesus. Amen? And Jesus himself said, it is better that this man would have not been born. church that save ourselves from this untoward generation. We need to have the Spirit of God. Never overlook the love of God. Never take advantage of the love of God. Because the love of God, the purpose of the love of God, to lead people to repentance, that is the purpose of the love of God. And if you're still living a life that is displeasing to God, you need to think twice this morning. Because we are living at a very borrowed time in these last days, where anything can happen sooner than anything, anytime. And now God's still calling people to repentance and still giving them chance to make it right with God. Amen. Before it's too late. Hallelujah. And repentance is simply going back to God. You repent from that worldly sinful ways and go back to God and acknowledge Him as your Savior and Redeemer this morning. In Amos 8:11, it's a well-known scripture to all of us this morning. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord God, that I will set a famine in the land, not a famine of bread nor of thirst of water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. Amen. There will come a time that you will not gonna hear the preaching of the word anymore. But you see now what coronavirus did to the whole world. The restriction of gathering together. You cannot exceed the number of 100 people. But I have no idea what will happen next after coronavirus. Now we still have the opportunity and freedom to come and worship God and hear the word of God. People have this stubbornness attitude in their heart, which they think, I don't need God. Let me save you from this selfish attitude that we have in this last day. There is a God who loves judgment. And Paul said, we need to see the love of God and also the wrath of God. The love of God can save you from anything. And the love of God was shown at Calvary when He gave His life to die for the sin of the world. He purchased the redemption of the human race. That is the love of God. He died. But this time He's not going to die again at the cross. He's going to make sure everyone that is living that sinful life that cost Him that sacrifice on the cross will pay the consequences. Amen. We love to preach about heaven. How about we preach about hell? Because they are both real. You love heaven, but let me tell you this morning, hell also is real. It's just because that God is love that gives you the authority, that gives you the freedom to live according to your own way of thinking. Let me tell you this morning. This God also can judge sin according to His word. And that time is coming. And Jesus said, you will see all these signs of the last time. Rumors of war, nation raised against nation, famines and pestilence. There will be earthquake in diverse places. Praise God. Earthquakes happen everywhere in the world. Typhoons happen everywhere in the world. Tsunamis happen everywhere in the world. All kinds of things happen everywhere in the world. And all these frightened images in the heavens, where people saw these new stars, they just come to observe that there are some other new creatures who's never been observed in the history of this whole world. But Jesus says, it's coming. There is no remedy about this, because it will come to pass, as the word of God says. It will come to pass. It will come to pass. It will come to pass. and hell is real. If only God today will take you to hell to show you how people are repenting from hell at this very moment. As we can read in the book of Luke chapter 16 about Lazarus and this rich man. Why did God make such a story? Why he allowed Luke to write down this story? When this rich man was crying and weeping and asked God for another chance in heaven. And he said something. Please, Abraham, can you send someone to my family down on earth to tell them not to follow this pathway? And this what God is telling the church. There is a request made on your behalf before God from hell. And those are those people who are in hell right now. Asking God, God, please make my family believe that there is a hell for them not to come this place. It's not a place that you wish to go and spend your eternity. That they need to serve you. The man is concerned about his family. What happened when he was here on earth? He don't care about his family. He don't care about God. He don't care about anything to do with the word of God. All he cared about was the luxury that he has to experience in this life. Living a life of a rich man. And now, he arrived to his destiny, then he realized it is the wrong decision to make. And this is what Abraham told the man. Just remember those times that you had while you were still on earth. Over here, it's too late for everything. They are begging a 1 minute of repentance, and God never gave them that opportunity. Why? It's too late for everything. Peter said, straight after the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, save yourself from this world and generation. We need to have a hunger and thirst after the things of God. We need to make it our business, our effort, that every day that we woke up, God should be the center of everything. God has to be the one that needs to show me the way this morning. Hallelujah. Lazarus, what happened to you, Lazarus? What happened to you, Lazarus? Lazarus said, I thought that this is it, living a good life. Have no desire to serve God. Every time that God will prepare myself to preach a sermon on an evangelistic meeting, God will always take me to hell to hear all those prayer requests that is now coming from hell when it's supposed to come from the altar of sacrifice. Now they are begging for one more church service. Now they are begging for one more preaching of the word. Now they are begging for one more fellowship of the brethren because they want to make it right with God. And Abraham said, it's too late for everything. And God will always, always tell me, you need to convince the people that there are prayer requests in hell, that they are praying to God, God, please send some prophet and some preachers to my home down on earth to tell them not to follow the same. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Save yourself. Everybody say, save yourself. Forget about the one sitting beside you right now at this very moment. You need to have this intimate relationship to make sure that your spirit have the spirit of God inside of you. Now people who strive to live the life that the world wants to identify themselves with, Now it's coming to an end. 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 Where is the rich people? I wish that God will show you what is going on right now in the hearts of all these business people in the whole world. Why? Everything is coming down. The value has decreased. Why? Because of the chaos. There is a lot of adjustment is going around in this world, in this business world, in all this political world. Everybody is running to and fro. And Isaiah said, there will be no remedy for all of this, because Jesus said it will come to pass. But we as the church, Jesus said, even the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. This is the safest place to be in such a time as this, to be in the presence of God, to be in the church of the living God, to have this relationship with God this morning. The man is so concerned about his family. He knows he cannot save himself, but he was requesting God, if my family can someone tell my family, they need to save themselves. I pray this morning that everybody will come to his right mindset, to his senses, and make this day as the beginning of a new journey with God, because we still have time to make it right with God. Let's stand this morning. They were mocking Noah when Noah was preaching the word. Not only Noah was preaching the word, he was also preparing the ark. The ark was for him and his family, and the preaching was for the lost world. That's why Jesus said, go ye therefore and preach. He that baptized shall be saved. And Peter said, baptism is just a typology of the ark that saved Noah from the water.
Amen.
And Jesus said, if you're not born in water and spirit, you cannot enter. If you want to be in the safety zone of God, from all this chaos, from all this fear, find yourself in the presence of God. Hallelujah. So this morning, I'm going to ask each and every one in this place, if you know that there are things in your life that you need to make it right, you still have that time, that chance to make it right with God. That young man, rich young ruler, came to Jesus and said, Lord, what should I do to have eternal life? And God said, follow the Lord. He said, I observe all those laws from my youth until now. And Jesus said, but one thing thou lackest. And the sad part of that story is, he won't allow God to make that decision on his behalf, to fix that one thing that he lacketh, that cost him his eternal life. Amen. So I want to preach to someone here this morning. If you have that one thing that thou lackest, you need to allow God to fix that one thing that thou lackest, because you cannot afford just to ignore that one thing that thou lackest, because that one thing can cost you your eternity. The Bible says Jesus was telling the story in Luke chapter 15, and he said, "This shepherd leave the 99 who is saved already. And when after that one that is lost, when he found him, put it on his shoulders, and he said to his friends, 'Let us rejoice because I found this one that was lost.'" And Jesus said, "There is a great joy in heaven. The host of heaven rejoices over one sinner that repents." What God was trying to tell the people, even though the 99 were saved, but there is more rejoice over the one that need repentance. So if you have some things in your life that you need to repent of, you need to make that decision now. Because God is preparing himself a church without spot or wrinkle, but a body of Christ called the church, which is holy, for he is holy this morning. Hallelujah. I always visualize that day when God closed the door and started to open the heavens and the bottom of the earth, and rain starts to pour in. And people are thinking, let me ask you this question. What will be the first thing coming to their mind when that first drop of rain hit the skin of their body without a shadow of a doubt? They will think of the message that Noah was preaching. But it's true. Because it's not Noah that closed the door. It is God that closed the door. Noah was the one doing the preaching, but God closed the door. So there is a scary thing that we need to understand. As a man of God, we can preach the word, but it is God that will shut that door. And no man, even preachers or pastor, can open that door of opportunity if God has shut it. Never challenge the word of God. Just pay simple obedience to the word of God. That's all it takes. Simple obedience to the word of God. And Paul said, if I'm preaching just to please men, then I'm not a servant of God. I'd rather please God than please men. See, in this day that we're living in, people like to hear preachers that preach things that sounds good to their ear, things that they love to hear. But the things that you love to hear won't save you. What will save you is the word of God. What will save you is the will of God. Let us pray this morning. Hallelujah, mighty Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh God, we thank you for the preaching of your word. We thank you, God, for this opportunity that we have with you, Lord, that we can come together in your presence to hear your word, the voice of your spirit, oh God, echo into our heart, to walk us, oh God, and to give us this chance to make it right with you. I pray, Lord, that every heart, that every ear that have heard your word today, that they will respond to the preaching of your word, O God, and make that step of faith toward this altar to make it right with you, Jesus. And I pray, Lord, as your word say, that your word will not return void, but will do according to the will of your spirit, before it goes back to your presence. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. This morning, as we go now.